Now let's apply work energy approach to a few problems. So this is example 4.1. This is a solved example. In this problem, we have a ball that is sliding down a cylindrical surface, and the ball is given a slight nudge from rest. So it's given a slight nudge. So we know that its initial velocity is actually zero, and that position is shown as one over here. So given, let's start writing that. So given is V1 is zero. It starts from rest at the top of a semicylinder and slides downward. If the mass of the ball is M, the radius of the semicylinder is R. So we also know mass, the radius, and friction between the ball and the semicylinder is negligible. Determine the angle theta at which the ball separates from the semicylinder. So we also know that at the point when the ball separates from the cylinder, the normal reaction from the cylinder on the ball would be equal to zero. So we know that at the angle theta, which we have to determine, n is zero. So we solve this problem using Newton's second law in example 3.9. So you can apply Newton's second law. Now remember, every problem that can admit work energy approach can also admit Newton's second law. So you can always use Newton's second law if you feel comfortable that way. But if the problem in the exam or the quiz or the homework asks you to solve the problem using work energy approach, then you have to use work energy approach. Okay, so if you apply Newton's second law, you will see that you'd have to do, you know, integration and all that stuff. But let's see if we can somehow simplify the problem using work energy approach. So the first step from the general method is to apply the test, right? So the test says, is there a finite displacement? And the answer to that question is yes, because the ball moves from 1 to 2, and that's a finite displacement scenario. And the second is that you are relating forces with the position and the change in velocity, and that's true here as well. So you are relating the forces, velocity, and the displacement. In this case, there's no acceleration that is being asked for. So the test is positive. So now let's try to use the work energy approach. First step is to choose a coordinate system and show it, right? So in this case, we can use a tangent normal system, we can use r theta. So let's say we will pick r theta system. All right, so I'm going to draw this once again. So that's my cylinder. And between 1, this is where the particle is, and at 2, where the particle leaves the surface, and this angle is theta. I'm going to pick some intermediate position of this particle p, okay? And I will show my coordinate system since I'm picking r theta. So this will be er hat and this will be e theta hat. Downward is the e theta hat because the counterclockwise direction is the angle clockwise direction is the increasing theta direction, right? Okay. Then the second step is to do as much kinematic analysis as you can do. So kinematic analysis. And the goal is to get the velocity. So velocity in r theta is this. And this is clearly zero because r never changes. R is always equal to the radius of the semicylinder. So velocity is equal to r theta dot e theta hat. And the small r is capital R. So this is r theta dot e theta hat. So that's the velocity. So if we know theta dot, the rate of change of theta, then we know the velocity at all instant, right? But that is not something we know. So kinematic analysis tells us that V is known as a function of theta dot, but we don't know what exactly that quantity is. So let's move on to the next step, which is to draw free body diagram. So I'm going to pick a generic position right over here. This is at some angle theta. In fact, I'm going to call this angle at which it leaves as theta zero. Okay, so that's what we are trying to determine. So find is theta at zero such that the normal is zero at that instant. So we'll call that n zero as well, okay? While theta would indicate our position variable for the particle. So free body diagram is my particle. That's my coordinate system, which we always show. And then I have my normal reaction. Let me pick a different color for that. I have my normal reaction. I have force of gravity acting downward. There's no friction. So there is no other force, right? Okay. So this angle will also be theta, of course. All right. So this is our free body diagram. The next step in the method is to identify the forces that do any work. Okay, so let's look at N. Will N do any work? No, because N is always perpendicular direction of displacement, which is along E theta hat, right? And that means that N will not do any work. Mg, of course, will do some work, right? But the one component of Mg, which is Mg cosine theta, won't do any work, but Mg sine theta would do work, right? So, but we know that Mg is definitely going to do some work. And what kind of force is Mg? So Mg is a conservative force. Since the only force acting on the particle is a conservative force, which means we can apply conservation of mechanical energy principle. Okay, so T1 is equal to 1/2 mv1 squared, which is 0, because initial velocity of the particle is 0. T2 is equal to 1/2 mv2 squared, but we don't know what v2 is. Okay, all right, let's write potential energy v1. In this case, the only force is mg, so v1 would be equal to v1 due to gravity. That would be equal to mg y1. Now, what is y1? To write y1, we have to pick a datum, right? The horizontal reference line. So let's say we will pick our horizontal reference line to be this. So I'm going to show this as my datum. Whenever you solve the problem, make sure that you always show the datum, because without that, I have no idea from where you are measuring distances. So y1 in this case would be mg times r, because this is y1 and that's equal to r. Okay, what will be v2? V2 would be again v2 due to gravity, and that is mg times y2. Okay, so what is y2 over here? So y2 is this distance, okay, and that is equal to r cosine theta. So that is equal to mg times r cosine theta. And I can write cosine theta as 0, but it doesn't really matter. So I'm just going to leave it as cosine theta. And in the end, I will substitute that to be equal to theta 0. Okay, so now let's substitute 1, 2, 3, and 4 into the conservation equation. Okay, so we have 0 plus mg times r equal to 1/2 mv2 squared plus mg times r cosine theta. So that gives us, m cancels everywhere, that gives us v2 squared over 2 equal to gr 1 minus cosine theta, or v2 squared is 2gr 1 minus cosine theta. Now we have also seen from kinematic analysis that v is equal to r theta dot. So let's substitute that. So we get r squared theta dot squared equal to 2 gr 1 minus cosine theta. So we get theta dot squared equal to 2 g over r 1 minus cosine theta. Right? Okay, so that's theta dot squared. And we will now try to solve for, you know, theta over here, which is something that you would have actually done if you were using Newton's second law to solve this problem. So let's go back to our original question. So original question is, what is the theta at which the normal reaction becomes zero, right? So first of all, we need to have some relationship between the normal reaction and maybe theta dot over here, right? So if you go back to looking at the free body diagram over here, okay, we can write Newton's second law for this free body diagram. Now remember, we are going to be writing Newton's second law, but we are not actually going to be using it to solve for theta dot, right? Which is what we would have done if we were using the kinetics principle from the third module. So we can write sigma f equal to ma, and we have n, which is pointing along the direction. We have minus mg cosine theta, that's along er hat direction, plus mg sine theta equal to m times acceleration, which is r double dot minus r theta dot squared er hat plus 2r dot theta dot. And this is from the kinematics of particles module, right? So r double dot is 0 because r is constant, which is capital R. R dot is 0 as well, right? So what we have here is, let's compare the coefficients of unit vectors. N minus mg cosine theta equal to minus m r theta dot square. Okay, so that's one equation, we'll call it 5. And then the other is mg sine theta equal to m r theta double dot, we'll call it number 6. Okay, so we are interested in the angle at which normal reaction becomes 0. So let's just focus on equation number 5 then. So when n is 0, so when n equal to 0, from 5 we get minus mg cosine theta equal to minus mr theta dot square. Now theta dot square from here is 2gr, so let's substitute that, 2g over r, 1 minus cosine theta. And the reason we are doing this is because we are interested in angle only, right? So if we can write theta dot in terms of theta, which is what we are doing over here, then that simplifies things for us. So m cancels, r cancels, g cancels. So we get minus cosine theta equal to minus 2, 1 minus cosine theta. So minus minus becomes plus. So what do we get? We get 3 cosine theta equal to 2, which means cosine theta is 2 over 3, which means theta is cosine inverse of 2 over 3. And that's it. That's problem solved. Okay, let's look at another problem. This is example 4.3. So here we have a block of mass M, 20 kilogram. So this is the block connected via a pulley at D. This is where the pulley is, to the winch at E. So here's a winch at E by an inextensible cord. The winch exerts a constant force P equal to 130 Newton on the cord. The friction between the block and the horizontal bar on the block on which the block slides is negligible, letting H equal to 0.8 meter. So we know what this H is. If the block starts from rest in the position shown, so it is at rest here, so we'll call it position 1, V1 is 0. Determine the speed of the block when it has moved the distance d equal to 1.15 meter and is directly under the pulley. So the final position of this block is right under the pulley, and this is position 2. Okay, so in fact, I'm going to call this distance over here b instead of d, you know, for the reason that will become clear very soon. Okay, so what are the things given to us? So given is the mass h, b, so this is actually b, not d, the force p, which is constant, and there's no friction. Okay, and we are looking for velocity. We're looking for velocity at position 2. Okay, all right, so first of all, let's see if we can apply the work energy principle to this problem. We should apply our test. The test is it a finite displacement problem? Yes, it is. The particle is at position 1, it moves to position 2. And we have to relate the velocities with the displacement and the forces, right? So the test is positive. So the first step is to choose the coordinate system, right? So where should we pick our coordinate system to be? Well, I know that my particle is moving this direction. So what I will do is I will choose the initial position of this particle, and I will locate my reference frame right over there. Okay, and I'll say this is my positive x-axis. So for a generic position of the particle, it is at a distance x away from the initial position. All right, so initially x would be equal to 0, and then eventually when the particle gets to position 2, x would be equal to b, right? Okay, so now we have this, we can do a little bit of kinematic analysis, which in this case is going to be a little bit trivial because this is just going to be x dot I hat, right? And there's not much, you know, we can do beyond this. Okay, free body diagram. And we will draw the free body diagram at an intermediate generic position, normal reaction from the bar, the force of gravity, and the tension in the cord, which is given to you as P, 130 Newton, right? Okay, I need an angle over here. So let's say this angle is theta. So at some generic position, the angle being made from horizontal is theta. There are no other forces, there's no friction. So let's now identify the forces that will do any work. So N will not do any work. Mg will not do any work either on the particle P, because both the forces are acting in a direction perpendicular to the travel direction. So the only force that will do any work is P, right? But even P has two components, P along this direction, P along normal direction, and the P along normal direction, which is P sine theta, won't do any work. So if you look at the differential work done by the P, it is equal to P cosine theta times dx, right? Remember, dw is equal to f dot dr. So f is p cosine theta, dr is dx I hat. So we get p cosine theta times dx. So the total work done going from position 1 to 2 would be integral p cosine theta times dx, right? P is constant, so I can take that outside. So this becomes p integral cosine theta times dx. Now, what about theta? Is theta constant? No, theta is not constant. Theta is some value here, and by the time it gets to the final position, theta would be actually 90 degrees. So theta is constantly changing as x is changing, right? But theta and x are not independent of each other. The value of the theta depends on what the position of the particle is, right? So now we can look at this right angle triangle at this general position. This is h, and this is distance x, so this would be b minus x, and that's theta. So we have tan theta equal to h over b minus x. So now from this relationship, we can actually find out, we can either replace x as a function of theta, or we can replace theta as a function of h, right? So let's differentiate this equation right over here. So what do we get? We have tan theta times b minus x equal to h. So let's differentiate it. We get sec squared theta d theta times b minus x plus tan theta times minus dx, because b is constant, equal to derivative of h would be 0. So what do we have? We get dx. So I'm going to write dx over here. So dx is equal to sec squared theta times b minus x times d theta over tan theta. Okay. All right. So we get that. And of course, we want to get rid of b minus x. So b minus x from here, b minus x from here is h over tan theta, right? So let's write that. So this is h over tan theta times d theta. This can be simplified. Sec squared theta is, let's just write sec squared theta like that. And this will be sine squared theta over cosine squared theta, which goes to the numerator, and we have h d theta. These two cancels, so we get h over sine squared theta times d theta. This is d theta, and that is dx. Now we can substitute this dx in here in the work done, right? Okay, so w is equal to p times integral cosine theta, which we'll write, and dx is h over sine squared theta times d theta. Okay, so now this is something that you can easily integrate. Theta is changing from some theta 1, so theta 1, this is theta 1 over here, and this is theta 2 right here. Okay, so what is theta 1? Let's write theta 1 and theta 2. So theta 1 is equal to h over b tan inverse, and theta 2 is pi by 2, right? So we know the thetas, we can integrate this and get the work done on the particle. Okay, so we get the work done, but what is question asking for? The question is asking for the speed of the block, right? Okay, so we can write w equal to delta t. Notice that we cannot really use conservation mechanical energy principle over here because we know nothing about the nature of P. It's a constant force, right? We cannot create a potential energy function for P. So we have to resort to using our general equation, which is W equal to delta T. So W is obtained, and this is equal to change in kinetic energy, half mv2 squared minus half mv1 squared. This is zero because the particle starts from rest. So this equation gives you V2 right away.